We wanted the house to be rooted in the landscape and the countryside and where it was.
So the design and the build are all completely open-ended.
Yeah, you came here for 2 weeks, didn't you, Chris?
And he's been here for 6 months.
It just goes on and on. You can't abandon it now.
This week's couple are lucky enough to be building their house in the wild and beautiful setting of South Devon. And they're following a pretty wild idea too. They want their home to feel part of the earth. They're using old English building techniques and they're making their design up as they go along.
They're not starting from scratch, but rebuilding these ancient ruined barns into their ideal family home.
We wanted the house to be, that we built, to be rooted in the landscape and the countryside and where it was. And what can you have better than two old barns dating right back to 1600s, which look as if they've pretty much kind of thrust themselves out of the earth and they're built of the earth.
But you're not simply going to kind of just whack in there with conventional building materials, are you? Because it's quite, it's a barn of mixed materials itself, isn't it? The stone, there's also cob.
That's right, there's two barns. Walls. There's a 1600s barn, which is built of half stone, half cob. And then there's the 1850s barn, which is mainly all stone.
So what's your approach to it going to be?
The objective is to create the house that we want. And since environmental issues are one of our concerns, we would incorporate those into the build.
We just don't like waste, really. If I could eliminate waste, that would be great. I really want to sort out the sewage system. Don't want it taken away anywhere or dumped anywhere or put in the sea. And it'd be brilliant if we never had to have someone come and take our bins away. If we could actually, you know, make everything work that way.
Recycle
as well.
Everything.
Yeah, recycle everything. Hi, this is the kitchen door. Coming
all right,
into
not the front door.
The kitchen, no, the front door's this great big arch here.
All right,
which is
there,
all filled in,
there,
do you see? So there'd be a kind of double height hallway. Uh-huh. Coming in through there.
So this obviously will be the kitchen.
This is the kitchen. And you have to imagine that wall doesn't exist.
Right.
And what in fact there is a glass atrium that goes out beyond,
really?
Which we hope to plant full height citrus trees coming up through because it's right down to the basement level.
Fantastic, so it'll be sort of split level.
Oh, mind the mud.
Mind the mud.
Where is the Mr.
There's
Norman?
A big hole full of mud there. So what's this down here? I mean, it's a dung heap at the moment, but I mean, what will it be?
So that's the garage, that's the lower ground level.
Okay.
And the utility room.
And the utility area.
Double garage,
yes. These two pillars.
It's not very
up.
Eco.
No, it's not very eco, that's
but
a
it's
fair
very,
point.
But it's
very necessary.
Very
yes.
necessary and pragmatic
yes,
living
yes,
in the country.
Absolutely.
So above it, what will happen?
Well, the floor level, finished floor level, will be about where those two ledges are.
Yeah, and above here, is there another story?
Yes, another story above, which will have the bedrooms and bathrooms and that sort of thing.
Okay.
Working with an existing building normally gives you some idea of what you're going to end up with. But in this case, I'm finding it really difficult to visualise an end result, and I'm not the only one.
The philosophy of the project is to leave decisions about interiors and decisions about how the building evolves until they naturally occur, so to speak.
Does this mean that you don't have any completed architectural drawings for this project?
Well, we certainly don't at the moment, no.
So the design, the planning to some extent, and the build are all completely open-ended?
Certainly not open-ended, no.
No.
By the end of August, we should have a watertight building. We've then got 2 to 3 months, perhaps a bit more, to finish out the inside. Obviously, a lot of the inside can be going on during that period, but to finish the inside in that time.
And when will you then move in?
Before Christmas.
Definitely before Christmas.
Definitely before Christmas.
Definitely before yes. Christmas.
The 1600s barn will have a new thatched roof and will be rebuilt using the original stone and mud. The 1850s barn will have a slate roof and huge new windows, plus a double garage. Sue and Martin want to rebuild these barns in the same meticulous way that they were built originally, but at the same time incorporating energy-efficient 21st century technology. Decisions about the interiors will be made as they go along. So far, they know they want a south-facing sitting room and kitchen overlooking the indoor garden, with 4 bedrooms upstairs and a study. The old barn will be left roughly finished at this stage. The land and buildings cost £125,000. Their budget for the building work is £150,000. That makes a total cost of £275,000, which is coming from savings and a small mortgage. It's April, and from now on, Sue, Martin and their two boys will live on site in a mobile home. Martin's a freelance writer, but for the next 8 months, his main job is going to be project managing their build.
We like camping and that sort of stuff. Obviously, it's very different being in it for 8 months to being in it for 2 weeks. But also, Martin works at home. The children are mainly home educated. I'm at home, so we're very used to being in an intimate family situation, which we're all on top of each other. Road. There's now the question of actually getting the caravan onto the premises.
Now we've got to see whether it will come, well, it will come off the lorry, I suppose, whether it will work its way around into the yard. If not, I haven't a clue.
Everybody we've met today has said, if you want to push, we'll be there. So it could be people power.
Hold it.
We knew there'd be some problem getting it in, so that was to be expected, but it's a bit unfortunate it's got a hole in it.
Sue and Martin have just spent their first night in their happy holiday home. They're going to have to last at least 7 months in this, or so they hope.
And you are, aren't you? Just next door.
It's pretty close, isn't it?
A few feet away.
We're going to see it all happening.
If that wall came down,
yeah,
it
luckily,
would take the caravan out.
But it's not the one that's
it's
coming
not the
down.
One that's coming
However,
down.
However, all the roofs are coming down.
Right.
So yeah. There is quite a health and safety issue, I think, really, particularly with two small children of 3 and 5.
Lock the doors, shut the windows, and you'll have to be wearing hard hats indoors.
I hope not. I can't wait to see this archway open up. And Martin will have a good view of it from the project management office, too.
This is the executive suite.
It is indeed, the nerve centre of the entire thing. This is where we're going to the project
the
from.
The site office, in
this
other
is
words.
The site office, yeah. This is it.
It is tiny, isn't it?
Oh, no, it's big, it's adequate, it'll be fine. Out come the beds, out goes the cupboard. Big chair, nice swivel chair probably, good feng shui, powerful position. You see people coming in the door, you can look out at the works going on there, sitting here at your computer tapping away.
I can't believe there's any good feng shui in that.
Living on a building site doesn't faze Sue and Martin. They've been down this road before.
When Martin and I first met, we discovered that we both wanted to live in a castle. And we did live in one. When we first saw the Chateau d'Azur on top of the hill, it was exactly as you would imagine Sleeping Beauty's castle.
Welcome to the ancient hallway of the chateau.
They bought this chateau in France for only £60,000.
You can see the potential grandeur of the staircase.
After working on it for 5 years, they realised that restoring 17 rooms might take longer than they'd thought. So reluctantly, they sold it, making a profit of £60,000.
When we came back from France, we knew we had to rival it in some way. And we knew instinctively exactly what we wanted to do. We wanted to build our own house.
It took 4 years to find a plot, but after making a further £145,000 doing up another house, they're now ready to put all they've got into building their family home. It's day one on site. The very first job is finding out how much of the original stone is strong enough to stay. The man in charge of the building work is John Watkins. John's used to doing barn conversions in the area. But he's not used to working without anything on paper.
My initial feelings were one of absolute total horror because when I first saw the job, it just looked like sort of a builder's worst nightmare.
With this sort of project, it's always a problem because you never quite know what you're going to find. My main worry is the relationship with us and Martin and Sue because of their having to make decisions and living so close, they're never able to get away from the building site because they're staring at it every day. So I think that's my biggest fear, is that the relationship will break down, so communication will break down, and then it actually gets quite complicated.
Sue and Martin's other key relationship is with their architect, Adrian Slocum.
I don't think this approach to building work is for everybody. Sir Martin want to create a space for themselves and their children that is of the earth, creating something that breathes and that is healthy and feeds the soul.
Adrian's wife, Sam, calls herself a spiritual homemaker, and she'll be developing ideas for the interior layout with Sue. Like Adrian, she doesn't work from plans.
It's not going to be cast in concrete. It's going to be about dialogue, discussion. Creative conflict's going to be part of that. And it may get sticky at times, but I think if we can keep communicating and we can keep listening to each other, that we can make it through. And as we breathe, we imagine that we're passing through a door and we're moving back into the past, back into a time when you were truly happy.
Hello, Kevin.
Hello.
This is Sam.
Oh, hello, Sam.
Hello, Kevin.
What were you two up to just round the corner then?
We were meditating.
On what?
The interior of the house.
Uh-huh.
So far we've looked at it from the outside in, and now we want to look at creating it from the inside out.
Right. Yes. And Sam, this is your job to help Sue do this?
Yes, well, I'm trying, because I know more about meditation than I do about buildings.
Right.
So
is this the first time that you've done it in a cow shed?
No. I'm just finding my way with this, really.
Yeah, yes. Yeah. Because your husband is the architect.
That's right.
Of what will be this home.
Yes, I'm very familiar with buildings.
Yeah, yeah. And so you were meditating on the inside of the building.
Yes.
But with your eyes shut.
Yes.
Well, we're doing a meditation where we look back into the past, and Sue tunes into times where she's felt really happy and free and contented, and then we draw that into the present, so that she makes the connection with her own experience.
Well, that's rather interesting, because most people, when they have a great vision, when they build their dream, often build something that they think is going to make them happy, something they've never had. Whereas what you're saying is you focus on things that have made you happy in your past and put them in. The evolutionary approach to building a house is a lovely idea. As the build grows, you base your ideas on what you find out, what the build tells you. But there are some things which you really ought to do in a more conventional, logical way. Things like getting a site survey done, drawing up some plans, drawing up a basic spec. Things which Sue and Martin haven't really done.
A few weeks into the build, and they've discovered that the old planning drawings which they've been using miscalculated the height of the floors by 3 feet. To make Sue and Martin's garage, they'll now have to dig down. That means the old walls need to be underpinned, the first test for their eco principles.
It was a big shock a few weeks ago when I realised that, you know, everyone around me was thinking they would just pour tons of concrete underneath the building. And I was very shocked. And for 2 weeks, you know, I've been busy trying to find out what the alternatives are. And so, to be fair, as everybody else. And we discovered there are things you can do that are alternatives to footings or underpinning in concrete. And they involve lime and rubble and that sort of thing. But the cost is A, financial, so they cost about 5 times as much as concrete, and secondly, time. So we've come to a compromise after a long, long discussion that in the same way as PVC, where we said we don't want PVC anywhere, but if we have to have it, it can only go underground. And we've now said the same about concrete, basically.
Sue's been reluctant to agree to concrete because although it's the quick and easy option, it's also about the most polluting building material you can use. The manufacturer of its main constituent, cement, produces 10% of the world's man-made carbon dioxide.
It is inevitable that if you try and use a green approach to repairing an old building like this, that you will have to compromise somewhere. Now, Martin and Sue have already reluctantly agreed to use concrete in the 1850s barn over there to shore up the foundations. But they have used here mortar made with pure lime on this much more ancient wall.
Lime is an environmentally friendly alternative to cement. It allows the walls to breathe and move, and it was what was used here originally. Because it never sets rock hard, Chris, the stonemason, can clean off the old stones and reuse them. Lime putty usually comes ready-made from specialist builders' merchants, but I asked John to show me how to make it. It's quite an explosive process.
How much are you going to chip in?
All of it.
This lime started out as limestone, which is quarried locally. It's then burnt, forcing the moisture out, leaving it with an avid thirst for water. So when you add water, it reacts pretty violently.
God, that's incredible. That's too hot to touch.
In fact.
Now, what's the difference between what I'm stirring here and what Chris is using over there? Same stuff, isn't it? Just
he's exactly just the same stuff.
Waiting 3 months for it to slake and then... And
yeah, it's been sitting there for 3 months.
What's he mixing it with, an aggregate?
He's mixing it with quite a coarse sand.
As for the concrete being used in the garage to shore up the old walls, it isn't being put underneath them as foundations, it's being set against them as a retaining wall.
You're examining your dam. So your new car park is down there.
Our garage is there.
You've got to excavate all of that.
Yep.
Out.
Yep.
And beyond, yes,
down to the drive.
Good Lord. And I remember you saying, so you didn't mind having concrete there, but as long as you didn't have to look at it.
Well, it's the smallest amount of concrete you can possibly get away with.
So, all of these discoveries, do they mean that the budget's gone up?
The budget's going up because we're making, in some areas, more rather than less expensive choices. For example, we're going to have far more oak in the building than we probably originally intended. I think it will end up higher than we'd initially planned.
And does your kind of relaxed developmental approach to this build, does that still hold?
If you want to react to a building as you work with it, it's the only way to go. If you just say, right, the architect's plan is X, and there it is in plan form, we're going to follow it, and you set it all in concrete at the bottom, you then can't alter it as you go up. Whereas if you can, to an extent, create the house and then set everything firm at the end, you've had a real chance to let the building have its say.
And concrete may be an unwelcome addition, but Sue's determined to give it some spiritual meaning.
This is a piece of the Berlin Wall on the day that it came down. And this is one that his dad picked up at San Paolo. And this is a crystal from the Sahara Desert. So we're going to bury them now. And then if we walk down, we'll know there's hidden treasure under here. So we won't just think about the rather horrid concrete. We'll think about all those beautiful treasures from the earth that are glittering under there.
They're 2 months in, and contrary to my expectations, I have to say, Sue and Martin's organic vision is going to plan. But Sue has had to compromise her eco principles by accepting much more concrete than she wanted, both hidden and where she can see it. And there's a long way to go. So, the big question is, how many more compromises are there ahead?
The success of the modern brick is all thanks to the Industrial Revolution. All that mass production, all those canals, helped spread its popularity 200 years ago and more. But before that, well, people built with whatever they could get their hands on, with stone or timber, for example. Down here in Devon, they had precious little of either, so instead, they built their houses out of mud, or cob, as they call it here.
Sue and Martin are using cob to restore their walls in the 1600s barn. Cob's a mixture of earth, straw and water.
Come on, Hugo. Jump on.
All right, then. Now, is there a hand solved?
The method for making it hasn't changed since people first built mud houses. Just tread it until you get a thick, sticky mass. You can pick it up quickly from an old manual. That's what John the Builder did.
You're repairing an existing wall, aren't you?
We are.
Underneath here is stone.
Stone, yep.
Yeah?
Most cob walls will have stone up to first floor.
Yes.
And then cob above there.
That's the base. And what about the roof? Obviously it needs some protection because this top wall's very exposed, isn't it?
That's right. I mean, in this case, it would be thatched. Most cob houses would have been thatched and the cob would extend out by sort of 18 inches over the edge. So the rain dripping off the cob is well clear.
Yeah. It's a low-skill job, isn't it?
It is, yep.
I've learned to do this in, it would appear, 1 minute, and I'm sure I could get a little faster and a little better as time passes, but in fact...
Yeah, come on in.
All right. Let's talk more action.
That's right.
Using mud from your backyard is about the most sustainable way of building I can think of. Here in Devon, there are more mud houses than any other part of Britain. And what I find interesting is how one material can give a whole community a visual identity. A third of the world's population live in mud houses, and from Mali to Mexico, mud has ruled the architectural roost for centuries. It's cheap, available nearly everywhere, and it's thermally efficient, keeping houses cool in summer and warm in winter. Back in Devon, it's August, and another traditional construction material arrives, the oak frame. Oak is expensive, and this frame is taking a big chunk out of Sue and Martin's budget. But it is a homegrown wood.
It smells very nice, the green oak. I think they should bottle it up and put it in an aerosol, probably. It's that good. 20 years' time, it'll be as hard as rock. You won't be able to bang a nail into it without drilling a hole.
The frame's going up 4 months into the build. It's the structural heart of the house, supporting the roof and providing a cavity for insulation between the frame and the walls.
It's a whole collection of very elderly buildings which have been built ad hoc, and the levels are all over the place and the walls are all over the place. So what we're supplying is the structure that holds up the walls and the floors so that we're not relying on the old walls, which are rather tender, to do very much work.
Sue and Martin are still convinced they'll be in before Christmas. But it's the end of August, Martin's deadline for a watertight building, and they're a long way off. Still, at least it's beginning to look like a house.
So what's it like putting your back against something which is, could have been growing for 100 years?
I know. I think it's... Well, it's quite awesome, isn't it, really? It really
awesome.
Is. Yes.
Awesome.
Yeah, awesome.
I know that awesome, but anyway, it's interesting. Interesting.
So this one's particularly special because it's the tree of life. It's our great huge trunk that goes right down into the floor, three stories down.
I know, it's an enormously tall piece of wood.
It goes right into the garage, and then it comes up here, and it's got eight faces with these five great arms coming off it immediately, and then there's three more up the top.
So how's the schedule generally? You've said all along, very organic. We kind of develop this design as we go along. You've still got a deadline, haven't you, of Christmas?
Oh, yeah, we think we're on target.
Because we're going to the autumn soon-ish.
Yes, well, we want to get the lid on pretty quick.
Yes. Yeah.
We've got the other oak frame arriving next week.
Yes.
Now, the thatcher will follow up very quickly. So by the end of September, given the reasonable patch of weather, we should have a cover over the whole lot.
Yeah, if the weather's good.
If the weather's not appalling. And if that happens, then I think we'll be all right for Christmas. I think if we get very seriously delayed on the roof, then that may push things back. But I don't think it will. You can come down here on Christmas Eve or 23rd or whatever and see for yourself. Come and have a drink.
I will.
We'll have our housewarming party.
Yes.
It's the middle of October. It's been raining every day for a month, and Chris the stonemason is struggling with the walls. Lime mortar takes days to set, and if the rain hits it, it just washes away.
This was built yesterday. And, you know, it's just like when I laid it, so I had to cover it up, because the water gets in behind it, because it's not going off, and you're putting more weight on top of it. If you're using cement, you know, you can build 2 or 3 foot, then build 2 or 3 foot the next day, but this, you build since it's been wet, I've only been doing about a couple foot. It's all right using these old methods, but it doesn't, you've got to have time, you just can't build one place.
Until the walls are up, the building won't be watertight.
Yeah, but we can.
But Martin's determined to carry on regardless, and he's driving the small team on.
And then flap it out.
He's still optimistic about the moving in date.
I still think we'll be in. It won't be finished. I never said it would be finished. But I think we could be inside by the end of December. I like the walls to be built, the slates to be on, the partitions to be made, the wiring to be done, the plumbing to be done, the carpets to be laid. But I guess it won't happen tomorrow.
You know, you're saying finished by Christmas, and we all worked on this type of job before, and we all look at it and think, well, he's going to be really lucky.
So we've got a temporary hiccup.
The south-facing roof structure is supported by acro props until the walls are built up and can take the weight. Only then can they put the extra weight of the roof tiles on. The pace of building with lime is causing real frustration.
Everybody's getting in each other's way, really, now. You know, you're trying to finish it off. And you do get to a point when you think, God, you know, is it ever going to finish?
Very pleasant building site, to be honest.
Chris has never known better. You only came here for 2 weeks, didn't you, Chris? And he's been here for 6 months.
Just goes on and on. He can't abandon it now. Unless his finances dictate he does, but, you know.
You know, the house in France wasn't finished for years, and I think they're probably quite good at adapting to living in a space that's not finished and being able to sort of be surrounded by work and chaos and, you know, I just can't cope with that. But I'm sure that they can. And if you can, then that's fine. And they can finish it off, you know, over the next few years.
Now Martin's kind of, you know, fully involved every day on the build and doing things. It's a slightly different life for me and the boys. Everything that's happened has been brilliant. We are completely happy with how it's all going. But I think we have used up our time contingency and probably our budget contingency as well. And so we're now on a bit of a race against time to get in at Christmas. I think it's frustrating to Martin because he's involved in it. And sometimes he goes out in the morning and he has a vision in his mind of what can be achieved. And he comes back, you know, and I'm saying, oh, it's looking great. And he says, no, we haven't done half of what I thought we should do.
Sue and Martin's philosophy for this build includes the idea that as much as possible of the building material should be traditional and locally sourced. So the walls are of stone and of cob. The timber frame inside is English oak. And the roof, well, the roof is covered in dried reed, in thatch.
It's the end of November, and over on the old barn, the thatcher's struggling to keep his reed dry. A job like this would normally take him 6 weeks, but because of the weather, it could take up to 9.
I mean, you're not putting a roofing felt on, are you, underneath it? It's going straight onto the, onto the rafters.
Yes.
So is it really that waterproof?
It works exactly the same way as if you imagine putting a drinking straw at an angle under a dripping tap.
Yeah.
The drip goes down to the end of the straw before it falls off.
Yeah.
And it was absolutely heaving it down. The surface of the thatch was just a series of drips of water dripping down, a quarter of an inch in, and it was completely dry.
Fantastic. Where does this stuff come from? This is
grown
locally?
No, this is water reed. It's from Turkey, believe it or not.
Not from Norfolk, then?
Not from Norfolk, no.
Why not? That's where they grow it these days.
They can't produce enough to supply the thatching industry.
So it comes from Turkey?
Turkey, Poland, Turkey. Romania.
In terms of environmental impact, you know, kind of, you have to transport the stuff, don't you? You have to get it over here in the first place.
Yes, it's not an ecological success story.
No.
It's a shame we don't produce enough reed in Britain. It's such a traditional product, and the thousands of miles it has to travel across Europe to be imported seriously compromise its eco-credentials. But then finding truly environmentally friendly materials to build your home is a real struggle, as Martin knows from experience.
Insulation is an absolutely key part of our project because the only real way to minimise your energy consumption is to have very good insulation.
After weeks of research, Martin's found a form of insulation that's very natural and very local.
Sheep's wool is not rocket science. It's not the most innovative thing anyone's ever done. But it's not widely used at the moment, mostly because it's not widely available and the commercial products are relatively expensive. But it's a real problem with environmental building is that these products are all so expensive at the beginning. It's like solar energy, everything else. And to do it sensibly, you've got to find a way of doing it cheaply or there's no point. You know, you're just not in the real world otherwise. So I found a local spinning mill which has sheep's wool more or less as a waste product of their spinning process.
Wool and thatch are natural materials, but Sue and Martin's philosophy also embraces modern eco-products. They're installing a heat exchange system which swaps stale air inside their house for pure air from outside the house. On its way in, the cool, fresh air is heated, which means that Sue and Martin will have a constant supply of warm, clean air without ever having to open any windows. They're also taking advantage of the latest in glass technology. The huge south-facing windows are being installed, even though the walls still haven't been completely built around the openings. But as this is the elevation most exposed to the prevailing winds, it's vital to get this last major element of weatherproofing in place. The glass units are double glazed and filled with argon, making them twice as thermally efficient as standard double glazing.
So how is your budget then, bearing up to these investments?
Groaning, I think, is probably...
We haven't overspent it, but we are reaching its limit.
You haven't finished the house yet,
have you? No.
7 months ago, you said, look, it'll be... Well, no, 8 months ago, was it April? You plan to be in here in 7 months, so you're kind of already past that point.
Oh, we're stretching it, yes. But then...
You've got a month before Christmas. Do you think you're going to get in before then?
No, I don't think so anymore. And I think, as I say, we could have done, if everything had gone fine for the last, say, 6 weeks. But the weather in the last 6 weeks has been absolutely unbelievable. Mm. But, you know, so what? If we get in, you know, middle of January or something, that's not the end of the world. We'll certainly be moving, sort of moving over from the caravan to the house during the course of January. I'm quite sure about that.
Yeah. You've got quite a lot of fixing to do. I mean, I haven't seen much pipework. I haven't seen any wiring.
No, but
there's no first fix yet.
Wiring doesn't take long. No, it doesn't. Come on.
And boards and walls and everything else?
Well, that takes more time, but we haven't got to do it all at once. We haven't got to.
Quite a lot of the stuff.
It'd be nice to get it done before you moved in, though, wouldn't it?
Yes.
I definitely got to have every single room boarded out before we move in. I mean,
many rooms?
If we do one room, it'll be bigger than the caravan. You know, it's not essential that the place is completely
finished. There will be some discussion about what point we move in, I can assure you.
I bet the blinking well will be. Yeah. He'll be living here, you'll be still in the caravan.
It's possible.
Possibly.
It's
possibly.
This reed bed system, which will be filtering all of the sewage from the house, is going to be ready and up and running in 2 weeks' time. Now that I can believe. What I can't believe is that Sue and Martin are going to be moving in January. That's only 5 weeks away.
It's the middle of January, and Sue and Martin are a long way from moving in. The outside walls are still being built, and the roof isn't slated yet. But worse than that, Sue and Martin are fast running out of money.
Money becomes much more meaningful towards the end of the build. In the beginning, you're writing checks for huge amounts of money, you're spending money on stonework, a lot of labour, a lot of demolitions, timber, roof, slates, you know, huge checks, huge amounts of money. And then towards the end, when you're down to your last sort of 20,000 or whatever, and you're talking about floorboards and baths and kitchen units and stuff like that, the money suddenly seems much more valuable. Like, you know, a week's wages to somebody of, say, 400 or 500 quid is, I don't know, the price for a sofa or, you know, a jolly nice roll-top bath or one of those things. So you start thinking to yourself, where do I want to spend my money?
Martin's decided that he can't afford full-time builders, so after 9 months, John and his team are leaving the project.
It looks like it's almost there, but I know that it's a long way from finishing. I mean, the actual slow bit, all the fitting is yet to be done, and that's actually quite costly and quite time-consuming. It requires a sort of higher skill level, so that costs more as well. But I think those are things that Martin's planning to do himself. So, you know, the more he does, the more money he saves.
It'll take a long while to finish the house. We've got Sue's dad, Norman, here helping me. And we've got Chris is here doing all the stonework still. We're getting stud work sorted out. The staircase is largely completed. I've still got plumbing and wiring to do, but I've done some wiring. It's not a big job. Only once in the last 15 years have I actually employed a plumber, paid someone to do plumbing for us. And although it was done perfectly well and competently and quickly too, to be fair, I did it in, you know, a week when we were away, and it would have taken me probably, you know, 2 months of evenings and that sort of thing. But still, it wasn't done quite the way I wanted. You know, got back and found the pipes aren't quite where I wanted. The pipes that run up to the radiator's not quite vertical. They're a bit wonky, and you can see the bends in the bottom and that sort of stuff. And that just, no, it bugs me really. I'd rather do it myself and get it right. It does take longer, and it is frustrating, and it's particularly frustrating for Sue because she has to wait longer. But even if we had people here, I'd be concerned about keeping them, as it were, fully loaded with work because I spend so much time working out what I think we should be doing next.
One outside cost he has to incur is the reed bed specialist. This is a crucial part of Sue's vision of a house with minimal waste.
Eco-wise, I'm most excited about this because it's part of the garden and it links the house with the garden, which is what I really wanted. And it is something, as I say, we're doing it for ourselves. It, you know, right from what we're producing down to where it's going, it's all on our plot, and we're not having to get anybody else out or use services that are going out there and polluting, really. So I'm really, really happy about that.
All right, let's try that. The first reed is in.
The reeds will purify all the water used in the house and send it back into the earth.
That's it. When will it be 8 foot tall?
3 years' time.
Amazingly, the progress of the build is still being held up by the stonework.
Is that roof watertight?
Oh, it's watertight now, but the wall's not watertight.
But that wall over there is not,
right, yeah,
because it's got a blinking grey hole in it.
Yeah.
And until it's watertight, you can't lay floors, is that right?
Because can't do a thing just... because of the humidity in the building, I mean, the moisture content. It's just too high. Normally, with floorboards, you'd lay them through and they'd get a chance to dry out into the ambient moisture level in the building. But in this case, if we brought in floorboards from a timber yard, they'd almost certainly get wetter here than they are where they are at the moment.
But you're very chipper about all this, aren't you?
Oh, I'm very positive about the whole thing, yes. And mostly because we've produced such a tremendous house, which we're incredibly pleased with.
But, I mean, look, if you're going to take it all on yourself, it's going to take years.
No, it's not going to take years. It's not going to take... it's not all myself anyway. I mean, we've got... all the specialist trades will be coming in. It's only the... well, I say all, not including plumbing and wiring. But to me, there's not, for some reason, not specialist trades. But I don't think that's right. I think that we'll... I'm not going to put a date on it because I've done that too many times, but I think that the next month or two or three we should be able to move in.
Chris said that he thought you might be in by Christmas, but not the Christmas that's just gone. He's talking about next...
Oh, everyone says that, yes. Everybody says which Christmas, yes.
So what are you doing at the moment?
Well, there's always three or four things at once. We're doing joinery, the staircase is going in. Yeah. We're doing these boards up here. We're putting them in bit by bit.
Yeah, this is not the floor of the roof above, is it?
No, this is the ceiling. This is the...
just the ceiling?
Just the ceiling. They're going to be painted, these boards.
OK, and there's a floor going on top of that, is
that's
there?
Right, yeah.
OK.
Yeah.
What else are you doing?
Well, wiring, plumbing, all the services going in.
So all the first fix, really.
Yeah, basically the first fix stage. When all that's done...
And meanwhile, Chris is rebuilding.
Meanwhile, Chris is still building
outside. Rebuilding the wall in the rain.
That's right. I mean, that's not so silly about it, but what...
And you've got a bit more stonework to do here, but, I mean, how much more stonework? I mean, a couple of weeks, 3 weeks, a month?
How long, Chris? About 3 or 4 weeks to finish the stonework?
Yeah, end of February, as long as the weather is all right.
That's not too bad. Doesn't rain too much, yeah.
I see you found a little studio for yourself.
Oh, I have, yes, yes.
This isn't a floor, is it? This is the ceiling. There's going to be a proper floor on top of this, isn't it?
There is. This is not
rather
what we...
lightweight.
We won't be walking on this, no.
Yeah.
But,
what are you doing?
Here, I'm mixing paint. Making paint, actually.
So has this become your hobby, as it were? Is this sort of... you don't have a television, do you?
There are many... Oh, believe me, I don't necessarily do it for relaxation.
And how is life in the caravan?
It's turned out to be OK, actually.
Yeah?
Yeah, 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 no, we're fine, actually. It'd be quite a shock to leave the caravan and have all this space, finally. Yeah.
And Martin, does he... do you go together much?
No, one of us is always looking after the children, so we don't go out much.
What does Martin use, then, to let off steam? Or does he just bash at wood all day, and does that do it for him?
I don't think Mark builds up steam. I think that's the point. You know, some people don't, do they? I was around getting sort of very agitated, but Mark just does things calmly.
Yeah.
At his own pace, yeah. And will not be hurried and will not be rushed, so there is no steam build-up.
And he can do that?
Yeah.
Day in, day out, month,
and then he
and
comes
month
in
out.
And does admin.
In the evening?
Yes.
For a hobby?
Yes.
Now that you see the floors in and the idea of where the walls are, you get a real sense mm-hmm. of how it will feel. But did the meditation help you envision that? Did it take you as far as that?
Definitely. I mean, the meditation was vital as far as I'm concerned. It was vital because it gave me the confidence to believe that my vision could be realised, really. Sam's done one picture so far.
One picture?
Of the main bedroom.
Yours?
Yes, a completed picture. And
okay.
It is the intention to do one of those pictures for each of the rooms in the house.
Sam and Sue have been meditating on the interiors throughout the project, and now Sam's starting to produce drawings of the rooms inspired by their sessions.
So here's Sue describing what she sees. The main bedroom is a beautiful room with light from all directions. I feel soft wool underfoot, blue like the sea. So here you can see this is a big blue rug. The blue and white bed floats out on the sea. Beyond it, the sunburst screen, a wall of glass. Through this, I can see the outside and make connections into worlds upon worlds.
With the bedroom not even a shell yet, most people wouldn't dream of decorating. But dreaming of decorating is just what Sue and Sam have been doing for a year, and now they can't wait to take it forward into reality.
Martin's putting the floor down this weekend, which means that we can actually put this room together very temporarily. Obviously, we're not going to move into it because it's not going to be plumbed or wired for electric or anything. But at the same time, if we can realise this picture, then we'll know that we can go forward on the same path for all the rest of the rooms. That's the plan.
Sue and Martin wanted to move in after 8 months, and they've been building for, well, nearly a year.
But at last, it's starting to look like a house.
So this view, is this how you'd always imagined it to look?
When I first came down here to push the children on the swing and saw for the first time what we created, because this is, after all, the front that we've created, because it didn't exist before, it was just very exciting, really. And it's what everyone sees from the road, these great big windows.
As you drive around the corner, this is what you see, isn't
it?
Miss it,
do you? People keep stopping and saying to us, hey, it looks great. People
it we've suddenly never looks like a house, you know.
Yeah.
And this idea that you wanted the building to be of the earth, to appear, to sit comfortably, does that still work?
Well, look at the colours. Look at the colours. I mean, they just are of the earth, aren't they? I mean, the earth is very, very obvious.
But I mean, round the corner where you see the cob wall, and you get the impression that the building has been there for thousands of years. Here, this is a domestic elevation, you know, with lots of glass in it.
I think in 3 years' time, when the windows are toned down and the stone is weathered, it's going to be firmly rooted in the earth and the ground, yeah.
And what do you do with all of this earth here?
From a very early meditation that Sam and I did up at the top of the orchard, where we sort of saw the house kind of surrounded by this huge green dragon protecting it. This little bit of bank that comes around here will be turned into the dragon's tail with a pointy bit on it. And this will become a great slumbering beast, and his nose will be down there.
Sounds great, doesn't it?
That's the landscaping.
Cradling the house. Yes. You've got more dragons, haven't you?
We have got more dragons in the house.
Dragons everywhere.
Well, good Lord.
Well, here we are.
You finished this room completely.
Well, we're getting an idea of what it'll be like finished, yes.
You've carved that oak pillar.
It's just started. You know, we've called it Green Dragon Barn.
Well, then now the whole barn is called Green Dragon Barn.
That's our house name, yes. We decided that dragons, you know, united four elements of earth, air, fire and water, which is what I wanted from the name.
I like these. These are old cow drinking fountains.
That's absolutely right, yes. They were actually cow in the barns when we came here. As soon as I saw them, I thought, hang on, we can use those.
You've turned them into uplighters.
Uplighters, that's right, yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
What I particularly like is the way that this wooden frame frames that extraordinary pair of big stone monoliths.
Mm-hmm. That's great, isn't it? The original one.
And so tall.
Is this good? Absolutely.
But through here is the sitting room.
That's right. We're in there already, pretty much, yes.
Extraordinary. I mean, look, now that this place is so empty, now you put boards down, suddenly you can appreciate the space.
Yeah, absolutely.
For the first time, really.
Yeah.
It is, it's big, isn't it?
Actually walk around
it. Is big.
And the sunlight pours in.
And that amazing view out of the window.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, it's heartwarming, isn't it?
And
all the green.
On a day like today, the light just floods into this space.
It does,
yeah, through all this glass at this end of the building.
It's great, isn't it? But particularly in the winter, the low sunlight comes right through. Mm.
And how are you going to furnish this area? Have you thought about that?
Yeah, I think this is where I'd like to eat, you know. I think we're going to have a long dining table here so that you can make absolutely the most of it three times a day and have the long row of chairs, you know, and none around that side so that everyone's looking out. That's the plan.
Looking at it as it is now, and thinking about how this room's going to be, there's an awfully long way to go, isn't there? You've still got your floors to lay, you've still got walls to finish. You've got insulation to put in.
And the wall to do. But there is only this wall. The rest of it is pretty much as is.
So the rest of it is going to be stonework.
That's right.
And this is the kitchen.
This is the kitchen.
And there's a substantial hole left in
there. A modest hole, small hole.
I think that's a big hole by anyone's
standards. It's the last hole. That's the last important hole. Thing.
Two days of work. You're 2 days too early, Kevin. That's the truth of the matter.
Uh-huh. And then your stonework will be complete.
And the stonework will be largely complete.
And your house will be weathertight.
Yay!
At last. But this well here, this is going to be your garden, isn't it? Your indoor garden.
This is the internal garden, yeah. So you can walk out over it.
Yeah, when we first met.
That's right.
You said this wall's going to go, and there's going to be a big full-height garden here with giant citrus trees.
That's right.
And here it is.
And there's the space, and I'll be planted
there's
one
the
day.
Shovel.
Come on, let's go upstairs.
And this new staircase. It's all your own work, isn't it?
Well, I didn't make it, but I put it together, which is hard enough itself.
What are you doing? You haven't moved in, have you, up here?
Not quite.
No, not as such.
We're just trying it out.
This is interior
design. Bedspread and all.
We're trying out colours and ideas and, well, this is the one that, you know, Sam and I really got a long way with her picture.
I remember,
Yes, so now we're trying to recreate it. So I must say, I can't wait for the day when I wake up and see that view. It'll be a good day. We're trying to see if we can get those colours, you know, trying to create that in order to, you know, carry on the inspiration through the rest, really, and get other drawings.
So where's this woody big screen thing?
Yes, this is the sort of window that's coming here, which allows us to see...
Between you and the mm-hmm. the well down there?
The atrium, yeah.
So we should be able to see the very tops of the citrus trees and out into the garden, yeah.
Right.
That's the idea.
Yeah. So now, where is your bathroom in relation to this? You're en suite.
A door through here.
They're just here?
Yeah.
So you're this side of the...
Yeah, it's not a particularly huge one, is it?
No.
But then, you know, actually most of the rooms are not vast in this house.
None of them are vast.
Quite modest, really. Mm. And Robbie and Hugo's rooms are now up here?
That's right.
This is your doorway through, isn't it? And you've got one room there and one room there. And this is your theatre space?
That's the...
This is the theatre space.
Much discussed theatre space, that's right.
So how far is this dream realised, then? How far have you got, do you think, down the journey together?
I think all the inspiration is here now. You know, you just feel like it's there. And I can't take him in. Sometimes I come out of the caravan and I walk into this place and it's pouring with rain or something. And it fills me with joy, it really does. And I'm not someone to whom that happens very often, but I do feel that it has got, in every inch of its kind of structure, things that are deeply part of me.
I just wonder that where you are now, Martin, you know, to an extent, you're going to want to carry on working on the place, that it becomes a very open-ended project.
Oh, it does. But fortunately, we've got room, you know, such as this, for example, in which to take that
to
project
carry
on,
on
to carry
working
on
forever.
I mean, you could go on for as long as
phase
you wanted.
Phase two and phase three, I mean, already lined up.
Yeah. Building, there are buildings.
Because you've got no builders now. It's you, isn't it?
Essentially, it's down to me, and that's fine because we can take it more slowly.
If it's single-handed from now on and you've got all this boarding to do, walling, flooring, so forth, I mean...
Well, I go on doing it full-time for another month or two and then it'll be more part-time gradually. Okay. Once it's habitable, I'll do it sort of...
Which will slow down...
It'll slow down.
So is there a danger at any point that you could just run out and find yourself minus some essential walls or insulation?
I think not. I mean, we did project the whole thing on the basis that we'd end up without a mortgage, which would have been fairly miraculous. As it is, we'll end up with a mortgage. And if we have to, we'll end up with a slightly bigger mortgage, but... We'd rather not.
Yeah. No, but you have put into practice for the first time properly and fully a philosophy and a belief.
Yes, we have.
About
building.
Your space, your life, and translated it into a building.
Yeah. Yep.
And that seems to be very important.
And
it is
at the same time, we have kept life in balance. I mean, I think the balance is important. We are okay in the caravan. This has not totally tipped the scales to become an obsessive thing. And if we don't get it done by a certain date, it's absolutely appalling. Do you know what I mean? It is actually... Okay.
You've got to live the process as well.
We've lived
you
the can't process and we're happy in it, yeah.
Yes. Sue and Martin have spent around £200,000 on the building work so far. They've got some fabulous interior spaces, and I'm sure this will be a very welcoming and healthy family home. But with Martin doing all the work in his spare time, there's an awful long way to go. Any self-build is something of a step into the unknown, but Sue and Martin's approach is braver and wilder than most, with no drawings, no schedule of works, no clear design. I have to say, I would not take such a risk. It's a bit like going on an adventure without a map or a compass. I mean, the whole thing becomes totally unpredictable. To be fair to them, of course, they have embraced the risk and the romance of that unpredictability. But as a result, I think it'll be a long time before they're safely home.